Hey, welcome to Family Church. We are a diverse, spirit-filled, life-giving church, healing hearts, building relationships, and developing leaders. My name is Ashley, and I am so excited that you've connected to our page today. Be sure to grab a notebook, pen, and paper, your phone, however you want to take notes, and get ready for today's message.
Good morning. So good to see you today. I was not supposed to be here today. I'm technically still on vacation. I had a great trip with my dad, if you know who he is. Pastor Joe founded this church in 1982, and we took over 5 years ago. We went out west. We did a hunting trip together. It was successful. We had a great time. I'm not the guy that posts pictures on social media of my hunting trips, but just know it was a good, successful trip with my dad. But knowing that I was going to be out of town and may not be back, I invited a friend of mine to come preach today. You guys know that I have been on a mission, my whole life mission, to kind of find friends. People who don't just tolerate you, but celebrate you. People that are like you, who think like you, who, and you know, 80% of men don't have someone that they would consider a best friend or even a close friend. Someone that they could confide in or go to in a time of trouble. And at just the right time, I met this guy. His name is Guy. This guy. And he brought me into his circle. He brought me into his community. He connected me with other people like us. We have a very similar personality. And he has just been that kind of friend to me. We text every week. We talk on the phone. And I just wanted to bless you guys with his gift. He'll give you a little bit more of his backstory when he comes up. Would you guys welcome Guy Wasko to the stage, please?
Love you, bro. Good morning, Family Church. Well, I was going to preach on life's purpose, but since Mike mentioned that I know all of his dirty secrets, maybe we'll just talk about that today. Is that okay, Pastor? Is that all right? Well, it's great to be with you. My name is Guy. Like I said, I pastored in the local church for about 22 years, and about 2 years ago, after planting and pastoring a church in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, God opened up the opportunity for me to hand the leadership of that church over to new leadership, and I now serve on a ministry called Compassion International. We rescue and release, a couple people have heard of Compassion. We release children from poverty in Jesus' name through the local church around the world. Since 1952, started in South Korea, and now we work in 27 countries, opening two more. Myanmar is one of them, which is just a really incredible, beautiful place that needs the hope of Jesus and lots of kids rescued from poverty. There's 2.1 million kids in our program. Like I said, we work through 8,300 different local churches, and it's just an incredible honor to be able to be on team with that ministry. And I wanted to say thank you to you, Family Church, for helping to support and rebuild houses in Haiti after the last hurricane. So give yourselves a round of applause. I think Family Church, I think you guys were able to build between 6 and 10 kids because, 6 and 10 kids, listen to me. It's a different program. 6 and 10 houses because of your generosity, so thank you for that. I do want to teach out of Ephesians chapter 2 today, so if you have your Bibles, your apps, you can look at that. It'll also be on the screen today. We're going to be talking about living on mission or a life of purpose. I was on a train recently, and I had to sit down in the only open seat, Pastor John Mark, and right next to me was this young woman named Courtney. How do I know that? Courtney introduced herself to me right away. And I was like, oh, this is going to be one of those train rides. Here we go. You know how it is. You sit down in public transportation. You got your AirPods in, your headphones. You want to sit and just, like, do your own thing, right? Not today. Courtney proceeded to tell me about her entire life. Most interestingly, Courtney's boyfriend, at the time at least, was the drummer for John Mayer. And that's pretty cool. I'm like 1 degree separation from John Mayer right now. That's pretty amazing. I don't know all of his music, but he's an incredible musician, and he's kind of famous and has a lot of money. I wouldn't mind meeting John Mayer, but anyway, that's not the point. The point is Courtney, without me even asking her, started sharing her entire life story with me. She needed me to know, a perfect stranger, that she was important. Who she was connected to, what her story looked like. She needed validation from me, a perfect stranger, and she had no problem telling me who she was and who she's connected to, the places that she's been. And you know what? It's not just young people like Courtney that are strangers on a train that wrestle with life's purpose and security and identity and why they're on this planet. I was with a family member recently sitting on their front porch in Virginia sipping sweet tea because that's what you do in the South. Can I get an amen? And I have a couple transplants. I see you. 70 years old, successfully raised their family, retired, has the life on a mountain, built their dream home overlooking the New River. And with tears in their eyes, this family member confessed to me that they felt like they didn't know why they were alive. 70 years old. They said, God, I don't know my purpose. I don't know why I'm here. And so this morning as we're sitting here, it's whether you're young or old, whether you're tracking with Jesus your whole life or you're just starting, I wonder if any of us really woke up this morning and wanted to live a life of mediocrity or a life of purpose. We don't have mediocrity in our bones. It's not put in our heart. My guess is we didn't wake up going, I just want to be kind of average today, Pastor Mike. Let me just kind of like float through and maybe not accomplish anything if I could just stay in bed. Now, for some of us, we are struggling with anxiety and depression, but you know that you're not made for that. Few of us, if any of us, I would argue this morning, would say, yeah, guy, my heart beats for boredom and just being purposeless. About 15 years ago, I had reached what I had thought the pinnacle of my career. I was a youth pastor and a teaching pastor at a mega church in Pennsylvania, and it was at the flagship church of this denomination. It's like 4,000 people there. I was leading a youth ministry of 1,000 kids. I had 9 staff. I had a big budget. I thought I had arrived. Anybody ever feel like that? Feel like you're there? But I want to tell you something, friends. You know what, family church? Every night for the first 5 or 6 months, I would go to sleep at night, tired, and with this deep sense of like longing that there was something more. That while I had everything on the outside, there was still something empty on the inside for me. I couldn't figure it out, and that sent me on a journey to figure out and locate a sense of greater sense of destiny and purpose. Have you ever been on one of these journeys? Where you might even have what everybody else looks around and says, I want that. Why would they complain? It still wasn't enough for me. There was still something missing. And that journey led me on a pathway to find a new friend, a guy named Dan. And Dan facilitated this 2-day custom strategy session with me. I sat in his living room in Holland, Michigan, which if you've never been there is an incredible place. They have tulips and heated sidewalks in the winter. This sermon is not about Holland. But it's a really nice place you should visit. Dan and I sat together and he helped unpack what was going on inside of me. He was one of those friends that Pastor Mike was talking about that for that part of my life would walk with me and help me figure out what was all twisted up. Why did I have this great job in ministry and yet felt unfulfilled? Dan helped bring healing to my soul, family church, and language to my longings and courage for me to step out in faith. And that's ultimately what gave me the courage to, during a recession, downsize my entire family, leave a job of my dreams, and move to New York City to plant a church in the East Village where I know approximately 2 people. And now, years later, I'm certified to help people the same way Dan helped me. So in a way, I can understand if you're sitting here this morning and you feel frustrated, like you don't know why you're here or what life is about, I get it. Some of us don't spend a lot of time thinking about life's purpose. Do you? Do you think about life's purpose at all? It's a captivating thing that's in our minds. TV and ads and Hollywood and our friends and social media all try to tell us who we are and why we're here. Most of the time, it's simply to collect more things and buy more stuff. But can't life be bigger than that? Can't there be more purpose than this? But most of us struggle. We honestly are like, God, I don't know where to spend my time or maybe where should I work? We have questions like, should I keep this particular job or do a different one? How should I spend my money? Who are my people? Am I lovable? These questions resonate with you. Maybe you have different questions. But whether you spend a lot of time thinking about this idea of purpose on a cosmic scale or not, lots of people have written about this idea of purpose and meaning. Here's a quote, Ernest Hemingway. Anybody heard of him? Grumpy old white guy. Life is just a dirty trick, he writes. A short journey from nothingness to nothingness. Welcome to church this morning, friends. It's going to be a message of encouragement. But we got to be honest for a few minutes before we can move into the promises of the word. And I want to be honest. I want to be honest with you that some days I've felt like life is just a dirty trick. You ever feel that way? You did all the right things. You talked to the right people. You prayed. You tithed. You showed up to church. You served. You're trying to be as obedient as possible, and yet it still feels like life is throwing you nothing but curveballs. There's definitely been seasons like that for me. Maybe you feel that way this morning. But this can't possibly be true, though, is it? But actually, the statistics tell us. Depression and anxiety impacts about 40 million, or 18% of the total U.S. population. And that was before the pandemic. If you're not tracking with Hemingway, maybe Thoreau is more your speed. Let's get moody here. The mass of people, he says, the mass of people live lives of quiet desperation. If that's true, then most of us, the majority of us in this room, are sitting here this morning with this deep nagging sense that you're made for more. Even if you're in a good spot this morning, I bet you if we had the time to sit together face-to-face over a cup of coffee or tea or whatever you prefer, lemonade or sweet tea, there's a couple sweet tea people in here, I know that from previous evidence, that we would be able to know that you were made for more, that there's been moments of desperation for you. But we also don't have to look at just old, dead white guys who are writing moody scripture, you know, moody texts and poetry. We can turn to the Word of God, amen? So we can resonate with this idea of purpose and strategy and meaning, but I want to tell you this morning that every single person on this planet, every single Christian has a calling. It is both universal and personal. Church, say universal. Say personal. It's both global and cosmic that everybody gets to participate in, and it's also specific. Let me show you. We are not created for mediocrity. Every single person has a calling. And historians, Christian historians and theologians have identified these core elements and the scriptures themselves, including Jesus. Jesus boils everything down into these two things. His universal mission. Are you ready? You could be sitting here this morning going, Guy, I don't know what to do with my life. I'm about to tell you. Are you ready? What do you pay me for it? The good news is it's free. The universal mission has two parts, one to love God and the other to love others. Guys, I spend my whole life trying to help myself and others figure out what they're supposed to be doing on this planet. Whether it's Courtney sitting on a train or my family member sitting on a rocker on her front porch with sweet tea, that boils down to this. It's not a mystery. God helps us to understand this, that every single follower of Jesus is to love God and love others. Friend, if you're confused this morning, if you're tired of feeling stuck, the Spirit of God would say to you this morning, start here. Start here, loving God and loving others. Even in the midst of this highly intensified political tension and the racial unrest and the post-pandemic moments and all of the chaos that that brings, even in all of that, you know what the answer is? Love God and love others. You see, friends, as we're thinking about trying to figure out our personal mission, I wonder if some of us get stuck because we're not being obedient and faithful to the global mission. We want to race past loving God and loving others and get right to, like, well, what about me? What's my purpose? What's my mission? And I wonder if sometimes we don't get to that level of clarity because we've rushed past the first one. So don't rush. Resist the temptation. I want you to settle in your hearts this morning, family church, that if you begin to care about God and care about others, that the rest will begin to fall in place. And it may be that the success or the key to encountering our unique purpose is directly connected to how well we're doing at making disciples that live this way. I don't understand how we think we can rush past all of these things to our personal purpose if we've not been obedient to what God has given us already. So, this morning, one of the application points I would just invite you to consider this morning, you know, today into your week is, like, take a little inventory. How am I doing at loving God? Am I being obedient with the things I know He's already given me? He's already told me. He's already impressed upon me. Am I loving others well? So, that's your assignment, and that's the universal mission. Your purpose is to love God and love others. Now, your specific mission is something that God has uniquely created just for you. It's qualified you to do and be in the world. So that's your second calling. We find this in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Paul, an apostle, has written most of the New Testament, as most of us know and are familiar with, and he's writing this book to the church in Ephesus, and he helps them to understand their purpose. The scriptures say, "For we are God's handiwork." His what? His handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. God has given you, friends, every single one of us in this room, a unique calling that only you can play. Something that's unique and specific for you to carry out the fullness of who Jesus is into the world. That's how he's made you. That's how he's designed it. That's his economy. And so, I want us to look at this. There's three parts here in this text that I want us to look at. Number one is God's handiwork. You are God's handiwork. That's what the scriptures say. One of the reasons I loved our worship this morning, which was just beautiful, wasn't it, Pastor Chris and the team? I mean, come on. That was insane. Thank you. Thank you. But one of the things I noticed about the songs we were singing this morning is it was all about the promises of Scripture. We were reminding ourselves about the promises of teachings of Scripture. Here's one of the promises. God has declared that you are unique and he crafted you personally and intentionally. That you are not a mistake. Say, I'm not a mistake. That's easy for some of us to say, but I guarantee you in a room like this, some of us don't believe that yet. And what the Spirit of the living God wants to do this morning is to remind you, is to look right into your soul, into your heart, and tell you that you're worth it. That he sees you. That you are not a mistake. You're not a glitch. You are a feature. The scriptures tell us that you are God's handiwork. He's crafted you and made you specifically to be in the world, in this moment, sitting here today. And maybe this message isn't for you. Maybe it's for somebody else that you know. But you, this part of it is to take this message and these promises to do good works. That's the second part of the scripture. Created to do good works. The original plan, if we go all the way back to Genesis, which we don't have time for, and we pick up the story where it started, what we find out is that Adam and Eve are hanging out in the garden, and the garden is pretty good. In fact, the garden is not perfect, it's paradise. Do you know why I know that? Because God gave Adam and Eve, the original human beings, an assignment. They were created to do good works in the garden. The Hebrew word that the author of Genesis uses to describe good, because every time God created something, he said what about it? It's good. It's good. I mean, it's good. But Moses, who wrote Genesis, we believe, had other words at his disposal that were better than good. You ever go to buy a paintbrush at Home Depot? You see them laid out on the good, better, best. And I'm usually like, how do I get the best for the least amount of money? Amen. So it's never the best paintbrush, even though it's probably going to make it a better job. But anyway, my point is, Moses had access to the same kind of language, good, better, best, and he used the word good. That tells theologians that the Word of God is inspired by God, by the Spirit of God. When Moses was writing this text, could have said, the garden is perfect, but he didn't. He said, the garden is good, Pastor Mike, because God intended for humanity to make it better, to do good work. I said I didn't have time to go all the way back to the beginning, but I guess I kind of did already. Anyway, let's keep going. Created to do good works. God has made something in you, you, to do something in the world that only you can do. It could be working with numbers and math and an accountant. It could be as a painter. It could be as a stay-at-home mom or dad. It could be whatever it is. It could be that vocation. It also could be something completely different. But what a great opportunity for us to be reminded of God's promises this morning, that we were created to do good works in the world, that we're here for a purpose. And the third and final part of this text is that God had done this in advance. There's intention here. That God saw the entire world over the scope and time is not held back by time and space. And he said, you know what 2022 needs right now? Needs you. Needs you in the Hudson Valley. Needs you in New York. Needs me in New York City. So in a way, God is saying, the table is set. What are you going to do with it? I've planned these things for you to do. There is purpose and intention here. There's agency as well. See, here's the thing, friends. I think God is a missionary God. He's a loving and pursuing God. That what was lost in the garden, he's trying to restore and renew. We just sang about that this morning. And you and I, this is the scandalous thing about the life with God that I just don't understand. That God has invited us to participate with him. That we're invited, not as spectators to sit back and like watch and clap every once in a while, but like to get involved, to put the jersey on, to get our hands dirty. The story of the kingdom of God as a missionary God is that we're invited as participants, that Christians are made new in Christ and created to love God and to love others, to make disciples along the way. Amen? That we're made for a life of purpose and mission and meaning. And so for me that day, sitting on the train next to Courtney, a perfect stranger, part of my ability to love God and love others was to see Courtney. Was to see past her attempts to like impress a stranger and to ask her questions about the meaning of life. I didn't lead Courtney to the Lord. She didn't say the sinner's prayer. She didn't give me a big check or even introduce me to John Mayer. But, part of my mission that day was to sit with Courtney and to see her and to love her. Part of my mission in life was to sit on that front porch with a nice cold glass of sweet tea and to rock with my family member and to be able to remind this 70-year-old woman who's had a successful life about her purpose, to love her in the moment. Because we're created to love God and love others and to live a life of purpose and mission along the way. Listen to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. Paul writes in another book in the New Testament. He says, "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us." I love Paul because he can be cheeky sometimes. You know what I'm saying? Like he could just get saucy. And he's just like, it's as if. Like his sarcasm drips through. It's almost as if God's original plan was to use humanity. How about that? "We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." The scriptures are full with these promises, friends. If you need more convincing, they're there. And so, what about you? As the scriptures continue to remind us about our life and purpose to love God and love others and to find our specific mission and live that out, that we're God's handiwork created in advance to do good works, what about you? I love the author Bob Goff. You guys are familiar with him? He wrote this book called Love Does. He writes in this book, he says, "I think God's hope and plan for us is pretty simple to figure out. For those who resonate with formulas, here it is. Add your whole life, your loves, your passions, your interests together with what God said he wants us to be about, and that's your answer. If you want to know the answer to the bigger question, what's God's plan for the whole world, buckle up, here it is." Bob Goff says, it's us. It's you. It's you sitting on the train or working at your office at your desk job or talking to somebody at the coffee shop. It's you and I taking what God is doing in the world to love him and love others and putting it together. It's deciding that this morning that we want to feel the weight of that, the power in our universal calling, and to begin living that out and then to also begin figuring out who we are, how God's put us together and stepping into that. So I just want to give you three really practical questions. Is that okay? This has been really helpful for me and others, I think, over the years. So we've seen what God is saying about purpose and possibility and meaning, but I want to give you these three questions that I think are really helpful as we think about this topic this morning of living a life of purpose. These are from Pastor Tim Keller, who pastored for years in New York City, a church called Redeemer. He said, first of all, what do you love? What do you love? What are you passionate about? If nobody's going to tell you what to think about, what do you automatically begin dreaming about and imagining? If nobody's controlling your thoughts, where do you naturally go and spend your time, your resources? As you begin to pay attention to what your heart is passionate about, clues begin to unlock about your purpose in the world, about how God has created you in advance to do good works. Everybody with me, Family Church? The second question, what are you good at? This is your ability. You've got your heart, your passion, but I could be really passionate about playing the violin, but I want to tell you, I'm really bad at playing the violin. You know why? Because I have no skill in it. I barely have enough rhythm to clap on beat. I'm not going to be able to play a violin and read sheet music. Come on, somebody. My passions begin to give me a clue, but what you're good at, natural skills, talents, abilities, there's another set of clues. My dad's an accountant, and I failed eighth grade math, so I want you to know I was never destined to become an accountant. There are people in the world for that, and they're called dad. Number three, where's the opportunity? Where's the open door? The God of the universe has created you to do good works in advance. Don't you think possibly that same God might be kind of like opening opportunities for you, setting the table, creating moments for you to use your passion and your skill and step into moments? I think that's possible. It doesn't mean it's always going to be easy, and it doesn't mean that we always sit back and wait for doors to be open, but where are the opportunities? If I have an affinity for something, a love, a passion for something, and a little bit of skill, but nobody wants to invite me to do that thing, it's probably not my handiwork to contribute to the world. Those are three questions that I hope they're helpful for you as you think about your own life purpose this morning. And so what if, Family Church, what if, not just as individuals, but an entire family, a church, began to live like this were true? What could be different? What if lives were filled with mission, not just spectators? What if every conversation and decision and place we go, we literally believe the kingdom of the world of God, and God, the ruler of that kingdom, goes with us? What if we actually thought that? What if this church, what if we began to actually, as an entire community, live that way? What could be different? Irwin McManus is a pastor out in California, and he writes this. He says, the center of God's will is not a safe place, but in fact, the most dangerous place in the world. God fears nothing and no one. He goes on to say, God moves with intentionality and with power. To live outside God's will puts us in danger, but to live in his will makes us dangerous. Family Church. Family Church, you have no idea how dangerous you are. You have no idea. Thank God of what's happened. Praise the Lord for the history. I had the chance to be here as my family sat right there on your 40-year anniversary back in May. Just what a beautiful thing. But what if Family Church is only just beginning to tap into how dangerous you are? The lives that will be changed. The people that will come to faith. The people who are lost and in darkness will see a great light. That's the promise of the scriptures. And Family Church, you get to be a part of it. You are a part of it. God's will involves every single one of us, every single Christian, loving him fully and others unconditionally and doing good in the world. What could be more dangerous? In a world, in a moment that wants to tear us apart and remind us of how different we are from one another, Family Church, we get to stand together and be dangerous as we love God and love others. And what if at the end of your life, the question isn't how you avoided sin? What if instead the question that God asks is, did you live a life of purpose? Did you love me and love others really well? Did you go on a journey to figure out what your unique handiwork is and give that back to the world for free? Did you do that? What if that's the question? And so this morning, friends, if you're not already a follower of Jesus, this kind of dangerous life is possible for you. And that's the invitation this morning. That you would turn your heart toward the life with God and begin to figure out what it is to love God and love others. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer in just a minute. But it could also be that you're here this morning and you resonate with this idea of feeling stuck, of seemingly maybe having everything, or you're just frustrated because you've worked so hard and you still aren't there yet. And you feel like your life doesn't have a ton of purpose and meaning this morning. You're skeptical. And if that's you, I want to pray specifically for you as well. That God would plant a new seed of life and hope that sparks something new for you. Not everything will change right away. It's not promised to be perfect. Remember, good, and we get to add to it. And so if you're not yet a follower of Jesus, I want to invite you to say these words with me, to pray after me. Say these words. Dear Jesus, thank you for your love. I confess that I'm a sinner. There are parts of my life that are broken, that are sick, and I need to be healed. I receive your forgiveness this morning. Thank you for making a way on the cross. Thank you for being my Savior and my Lord. Fill me with your Spirit that I could live a life of purpose. Amen. Now, yeah. And before I let you go, I do really want to pray for you, that if, for those of you that are struggling in this space, that you just feel like, yeah, neat talk guy, but it's not for me. Like, I felt particularly drawn during worship this morning that there's a real skeptic in the room this morning. Seriously, your heart is hard. And the kindness of God, here's the thing about God, he goes at the pace of you. And if you're going to sit there with your, like, metaphorical arms crossed over your heart and say, I dare you, God, that's fine. But I just wonder if you would accept an invitation this morning to just kind of start curling back your fingers off of your hard heart. So I want to pray. I want to pray for you, if that's you this morning. And if that's not you, would you pray for those people in your life that you know are just kind of just spinning their wheels? They feel stuck and purposeless. So let's pray. God, I pray for every single person in this room, that they would live a dangerous life. A life wildly committed to loving you fully and others unconditionally. And God, in particular, you see every single person in this room, but in particular, you know the people, the individuals, by name, their stories, their struggles, that are having a hard time this morning, God. They're really wrestling with life's purpose. Is it worth continuing on? Have I made too many mistakes? All the questions that would lead them to this moment where they're ready to give up on you. And I pray, God, that you would save them from that this morning. That you would give them just enough courage and hope and faith and peace that they would be able to take just that one little step toward you. And that, God, you would be so kind as a good father to meet them there. And so I want to thank you in advance for being that kind of a God that would both care and go at the pace of us. So we pray for fresh courage and faith this morning, fresh hope that every single one of us would begin to know exactly how we're meant to live, the handiwork that you've made us for, in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you, Family Church. I love your pastor. You guys are a dangerous church. I can't wait to hear the stories. Amen.
Thank you for watching today's message. My name is Ashley, and if this message has made an impact in your life in any way, I'd like to ask you to do a couple of things. First, we want you to like and subscribe to our channel and join us right here every Sunday at 9:30 a.m. or 11:30 a.m. The next thing I'm gonna ask you to do is take a next step on your journey, and we would love to help you do that. You can head on over to familychurchny.com or email us at team@familychurchny.com to get started today.